The following program discusses sensitive issues. Parents are cautioned that some material may be too candid for younger children.
Welcome to Pure Choices. My name is Michael Carducci, and I'm here with my colleagues from Coming Out Ministries, Pastor Ron Woolsey, and also Wayne Blakely. Thanks for coming, guys.
Yes, it's great to be here.
It's an incredible opportunity to just sit together and talk about our new identities in Jesus Christ. And you know, one of the things that we find tends to be very significant is that people wonder where we are. And you know, this is probably the number one question that we get. So what we want to talk about today is we want to talk about how it is that we identify and what kind of descriptions or adjectives do we put, you know, with that name of our new identity. And so from multiple angles and various entities, the world often operates from a reference to someone's sexual orientation. Ron, you're a pastor with a good knowledge of God's word. I understand that God created us male and female, but that's gender, not orientation. Where in the Bible does God talk about our sexual orientation?
You know, I've never found where the Bible talks about sexual orientation, but the Bible does talk about orientation. Jesus talks about two paths that we may follow. And having been a pilot in my earlier days, if I focused upon my orientation of myself, I would never have landed in the right place. Orientation is based upon your destination. And in these two paths that Jesus talks about, there is a broad way that leads to destruction, and there is a narrow way which leads to life. So the orientation the Bible speaks about is about your destination, not about yourself. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So Wayne, where does this all begin? Where do we start talking about sexual orientation? How did that begin?
Yeah, you know, I began to get a little bothered by the fact that somebody kept referring to sexual orientation. And like Ron, I couldn't find references to it in God's Word. But what I did find in my research that the surfacing of the term sexual orientation didn't come about until the early 1960s after the sex research that Alfred Kinsey had done. And what he did was he coined the phrase sexual orientation, and then as teaching began about sex education in the schools, both public schools and Christian schools, they adopted this term, sexual orientation.
So one of the things that I think many people that have our history that have come from is they truly question what their sexual orientation is and about their right to that. I know that we all identified as gay for many years, and in that we said that we were born that way to discourage any more discussion about it, or some of us actually believe that that was our orientation and an entitlement to it. So, Ron, any idea where that came about, that we have a right to sexual orientation?
I believe it has to do with taking our eyes off Jesus and having our focus really upside down. God's way and the law of God is based upon loving God supremely, loving others ahead of yourself, yourself last. When we're focusing upon sexual orientation, again, we're focusing inward. We're not putting God first. God has expressed very clearly how He feels, what He thinks, what He has created. And if we are really truly oriented to God, we're not going to be focusing upon our own fallen human nature, feelings and emotions and tendencies.
Okay, so help me with something, Ron. Make it practical, if you would. Tell me how that transition was for you personally, because you know we can talk theologically and as far as like what the Word of God says, but how did that translate for you? Someone who turned their back on homosexuality and is married with children now, how was that for you that you put God supreme and denied yourself?
Well, for me to find an escape from this bondage, and I really felt it was bondage. I hated my life, my life of sin and shame and stigma. And to really find my way out of that, I really just had to let God lead me and accept that he is a loving father, that he knows best, that if I would follow his plan for my life, it would be much better than my own plan for my life, because I could not see the end from the beginning, but he could. And it really is as simple as trusting that he knows best and patterning your life after what he has counseled us to follow.
Okay. And so, Wayne, you know, I really struggle because I know that there's a lot of people out there that were in our situation or are in our situation, and they really want to even understand that for themselves. And I think that there's a lot of confusion, and each one of us have gone through our own path that way. Wayne, give me a practical understanding of how that transition was for you. It wasn't until I actually met you that I even bothered to care about what my orientation was. Mm-hmm. I don't care if you call me ex-gay, whatever, but it was very important to you. And would you just share that practically with people that might be listening?
I think it really got personal for me when I was given the opportunity to share my testimony for the first time. And the lady who had helped bring about my conversion, I looked at her and I said, "So who am I?" And she said, "Oh, you're still gay." And I said, "No, that doesn't compute. Why would I have gone through what I went through to surrender everything over to Jesus Christ and still maintain a same identity? That doesn't make sense to me." And so I found eventually that I'm a new creature in Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17, I began to find the joy in the Word of God and who it tells me I am today.
So it's interesting, Dr. Michael Brown, who talks a lot about the gay issue in Christianity, he also says that this wasn't even an issue about gay rights and about the gay translation of the Bible until the sexual revolution, which was actually begun by the research that Alfred Kinsey did. So Wayne, is it possible that we've drifted so far away from God's plan over maybe hundreds of years or even just a few decades that society has adopted the idea that everyone has a right to sex?
I think we need to consider that because of the implications and the counterfeits that Satan brings about, and he does it in such a way that he doesn't think we'll recognize. A book was written about true sexual morality by Daniel Heimbach, and he had this to say. I found it was pretty intriguing. He says, "The gradual slide toward paganism starts when a person still committed to the Bible entertains dissatisfaction with something God says about sex, and a single logic connects a series of steps that extend from sliding ever so slightly from biblical teaching at one end of the full scale, attack on biblical morality on the other. Letting dissatisfaction fester sparks interest in ways to soften or remove the offending biblical teaching. At first, it does this in ways that do not challenge authority of Scripture, but only try to change its meaning." And so to me, this began, okay, here we go with hermeneutics. And so I think that Mr. Heimbach goes on in this book to talk about how the shaping of Christian morality has switched to what the culture is today, and it destroys the respect for the Bible.
Okay, so in recent history, how is it that we've become so hung up on sex and sexual identity?
Well, thankfully, there's more than one person writing about this today. And another person, Linda Bartlett, has written in a book called The Failure of Sex Education in the Church. She points out to us that holy is not sexy. God calls us to holiness. She says, "We are more than sexual beings. We are spiritual beings, body, mind, and soul. Therefore, more important than educating in all knowledge of sexuality is the teaching of identity and salvation in Jesus Christ." And so after I gave my life over to Jesus Christ, I had to say to myself, "So who am I today?" And so I today can joyfully say that I'm a new creature in Jesus Christ.
Okay. All right, so Ron, what's the big deal? Does it really matter how we identify, whether you're a gay Christian, an ex-gay, a gay Seventh-day Adventist? Isn't it just semantics?
Well, that's probably a good question to ask my wife. but she's not here, so I'll try to answer for her. I think she would be very disappointed and very surprised if she heard me identifying as a non-practicing gay. When she tells her side of our story, which she calls the real story, she talks about how she knew me before I went into the gay life. And there was no indication whatsoever to her or her friends that I was gay. And she knew about me throughout my gay life as being a good friend with my sisters. And when I came back to the Lord, she said, I knew if he was coming back to the Lord, he would be what I knew him to be before he went away. She has never thought of me as gay or as a non-practicing gay. And I don't think of myself in that term either, because that to me is negative reinforcement. Mm-hmm. I turned my back on that totally. I immersed myself in a new life. And I decided that if I am to ever have sexual fulfillment or intimacy in my life, it can only be in the way God has designed it, or I will do without. And so with that mindset, for the last 24 years and 23 years in marriage, I don't go around with the term heterosexual, homosexual, ex-gay, non-practicing. I'm just me living a new life with a wife and children and ministry, and I don't think in those terms. So I think these labels can really actually inhibit our growth with the Lord.
Wow. Ron, thank you for making yourself so transparent on that issue, because I think a lot of people misunderstand that just because that was your history and now that you're living in a relationship where you're married to a woman and have, you know, a family again, a lot of us want to know, like, was that a light switch? You know, Wayne and I, who are still single, it's been many years for me, and while we still struggle with same-sex attraction, we still don't live in that lifestyle. We don't live in that understanding, and we're learning the process of denying those things that call us from the past. And so, Wayne, what's the big deal? Why is it so important to understand this post-conversion identity?
Well, I think it's important to somebody, especially we reach out to people who are looking at unwanted same-sex attraction. All right, so we're starting to look at somebody who is looking to see if they can be somebody else other than what their attractions are telling them. So why would you want to secure yourself in the fact that you're gay? The only reason you come out and tell yourself or tell the world that you're gay is because you've been convinced that your feelings equal truth. But the Word of God tells us that if we're not practicing, or if we're not being led by the temptations into the behavior, we don't have to identify by it. We can share with somebody, yes, please pray for me, I have same-sex attraction. Mm. But I can be somebody not identified by my temptations. You know, you don't call yourself a non-practicing thief or a non-practicing adulterer or whatever the case may be, but somehow we've locked into society with this idea that's once gay, always gay. So even in a post-conversion experience, we're still telling somebody that they're gay.
Okay, so what I pick up from that again is one of the issues that I really, not offended by, but really turned off by was the fact that, listen, you're still trying to put a label on me. Mm-hmm. You know, if we don't have label, if one of the things that we're trying to do is get away from the labels, you know, why would you want to even be called a gay Christian when I want to be inclusive to the body of Christianity? And if there's not exclusions for different sins and different temptations, then why would I want to be singled out once again with another label called gay Christian? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, and so that's something that's very personal to me. So it sounds like there's a lack of biblically based instruction. And so what I really want to touch on now is by continuing to identify as gay Christian or homosexual Christian, mm-hmm. what we continue to do, I believe, is to drop off temptation, which God says that behavior is an abomination. And so if we're continuing to connect that to our identity in Jesus Christ, then I believe that what we continue to do is connect ourselves to that understanding and make Jesus' power mm-hmm. impotent. So, Ron, could you elaborate on that maybe a little bit?
When I left my life in the world years ago, homosexuality was just one of the vices. I turned my back on smoking and drinking and drugs and many other things. And so I don't go around today telling people that I'm a non-practicing pothead, I'm a pothead Christian, or that I'm a lusting Christian, but non-practicing. We were addressing a group of ministers a while back, and one of the questions that I posed to them was this: suppose I come to you and I say, you know, I'm a non-practicing pedophile. Is there a place for me in your church? Oh, and by the way, I really enjoy working with young people. How would you feel if I carried that label? I'm a Christian, but I'm a non-practicing pedophile. And the reaction was kind of unanimous. They're going, well, we'd have some problems with that. If we're non-practicing, then why do we call ourselves that? We were staying with someone at a conference not long ago, and the fellow in the home was telling us that he was an alcoholic. And I thought, oh, really? I mean, he's very active in Bible work and prison ministry and just on fire for the Lord. And the next day he brought it up again. And I said, Doug, when was the last time you had a drink? He said, well, 22 years ago. I said, Doug, you're not an alcoholic. You used to be an alcoholic. Yeah. You know, every time you say that, that's negative reinforcement. Mm-hmm. And it would tend to pull you down or lessen your credibility. So if we are accepting Jesus Christ, let's lay these things aside. Why do we want to identify with the things we're being saved from?
Thank you. It's beautiful. So when I was in SA meetings, which is Sex Addicts Anonymous, we would sit in a circle, and the circle, we would say, hi, I'm Mike, I'm a sex addict. Mm-hmm. And so what that did after a while is I realized that whatso a man thinketh in his heart, that so he is. And so that's not biblical. I'm not that anymore, not because of my own power, but because of what Christ has done for me. So when we're talking about the power of Jesus Christ, I believe that we minimize that power when we continue to identify with the struggle. As a matter of fact, gay Christian is not biblical, because the Bible says that the old things are passed away. And so if I didn't make the separation, even though I may have the attraction, by identifying with the temptation, I continue to bring that identity with me and never fully embrace the power of what Jesus Christ has for me. Mm-hmm. And so to me, this is very important to understand the specifics of that identity.
Ron. You know, in 1 Corinthians 6, 9 to 11, it talks about those who will not be in heaven. And homosexuality is one of them. It's listed in several different ways. And in my simplistic way of thinking, if someone is identifying as a gay Christian and God says gays will not be in heaven, then it's basically saying, to me, it says, I'm a Christian who will not be in heaven, because gays will not be in heaven. And if I'm a gay Christian, then I fall into that category of not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. If we're identifying with sin, we've not been saved from it. We've not distanced ourselves from it. We're limiting God's ability to save us. And I picture Jesus as kind of cutting away this ball and chain that's been around our foot. Mm-hmm. And that's like the bondage of sin. Why would I pick that chain up and then drag it around with me when I've been set free from it?
Wow.
That's to me how I see these types of labels.
Okay. Yeah. So Wayne, there's something that I really want you to address for me, but I just want to finish this thought. When I approached someone about this problem with masturbation that was still in my life, the one thing that he said to me, he said, if you want freedom from it, he says, you have to determine that it must die. Mm-hmm. He said, you have to slit its throat, you have to stab it in the heart, you have to smash its head. And so one of the things that I had to realize is I had to make a total and complete separation from this thing that I identified with for so long. And so the application is the same. So Wayne, what is the difference now? You know, we have this message going around like just love, you know, Jesus loves all of us. He just loves us, and we need to be more loving and show love to people. Is that still true? And is that where it ends?
Mm. Well, the love, yeah, the love is absolutely the core of what is needed. But love isn't permission. And so we've somehow, even the church in the time that we didn't talk about this, has finally come around to getting it into the discussion, but now they're still afraid of offending. And we need not offend anyone, but in the ignorance, we're doing more damage by locking people into identities that chain them to the world instead of who they can be in Jesus Christ. The love that we want to share, the love that Jesus shares, is that He will walk with us on the journey. Mm. And that that no matter if you mess up, that we don't let go of the person. We still see them as the potential that Jesus sees for them. We still see them as the person that they can become in Jesus Christ, not locked into the past, but by walking with them and saying, it's okay, another day has gone by and you've surrendered and you've given your life over to Jesus Christ. You're not identifying by your temptations, but you're beginning to see the beauty of who Jesus says you can be in Him. And Jesus gives us roles and responsibilities. He gives us engagements that we can have with Him. The devotional time that we all share with Jesus today, we start sharing with each other what we've discovered in Jesus Christ. And that inspires and motivates somebody else along the journey as we while we're walking with each other. Sometimes Jesus has to carry us. Sometimes as a church body, or as a caring individual, we need to take that person's hand and let them know that they're affirmed, that they're confirmed in Jesus Christ, but they have escaped from their past.
So one of the things that we've all experienced is that the church definitely needs a lot of work in the area of loving sinners, right? And in particular, even loving homosexuals. But that's not where it ends. That's such a vital part, and we identify that the church really has a lot of work to do on that area, but that doesn't mean that we throw out the power of Jesus Christ either, or the word that comes with conviction, which some people can find, you know, what's the word that you use for it, Ron? It hurts, it pinches, right? Conviction.
Could I say something more about the love issue from a parental position? There are two kinds of love, and we can say that we love our children and indulge their bad behavior. And this is what I see happening so much in the church today. There is this love that is loving people down the Broadway, which leads to destruction. I call it cheap love. It's not the love that our Heavenly Father has. When we realize that God is love, He's the perfect definition of love. He is a Father. And so everything that He does and everything that He says is from a loving heart. So that means His commandments, His warnings, His reproofs, His corrections, His punishment, all of these things are from a loving Father. And as a father myself, one of the most difficult things I've ever had to do is punish my children. But in love, I know that at times it had to be done. And what we are seeing so much in the church today is what I call cheap love. It's not a love that will love someone and nurture them along the narrow way. It is a love that will just kind of gloss over things down the Broadway to destruction.
You know, God's word said, to those that I love, I rebuke and
chasten. Yes, He's a Father.
Right.
Yes.
So Wayne, you know, in regards to the churches and the schools, you know, are they failing to recognize this difference? And are we more interested in becoming politically correct in a world that is just bombarding us with sexual identity, sexual freedom? Yeah. And it makes Christianity look kind of restrictive or even kind of old-fashioned or even hateful. And so elaborate on that, if you would. What's wrong with this?
Well, I think there's a certain amount of oppression that is coming from culture today. And, you know, if you choose not to have a biblical belief, that's okay. You have a choice about that, and nobody's forcing you to adopt that. But when you enter into a Christian school system, you should be able to get the purity of the Word of God and the compelling power of the Word of God. And so when we begin to bow to social pressure instead of living for the greatness of the Word of God that makes us a peculiar people today, we're selling people short of who they can be. And so I think it's important. I think that there's an importance. We don't have the end-all solution on this, but we have a lot of good, positive solutions having been there. And because the church refused to discuss this for such a long time, I see today that they want to be in authoritative position, and they don't necessarily want to consult with somebody like you and I. They want it to have come from themselves, but they're floundering a little bit, and I think that they're not giving the student who is searching the full potential of who they can be in Jesus Christ.
One of the things that was so profound for me in this journey, and you guys have helped me a lot with this, because you know you guys are more, what's the word for it? It's like for me, it was kind of like, well, just tell me what I have to do to get by. And so I was kind of moving in that direction. It wasn't until I really determined that this part must go. And before I could even realize that, you know, I tried to keep it. These are things that I loved, things that I enjoyed, things that I embraced. And so it wasn't until I really made the distinction that I'm not that anymore. Mm-hmm. And I may struggle with those feelings and attractions, but I choose not to be identified with that. I want to be identified by the power of Jesus Christ. And as I started to identify with that, even against my feelings and claiming the word of God, then all of a sudden that power became became real. It started to manifest itself in my life. I started to gain victories over areas that I didn't have before. I started to experience feelings and tendencies and tastes that I'd never had before. And so I think that that's the gravest danger, is that by continuing to put that identity in there, that I'm still an ex-gay or a gay Christian or whatever that is, I still continue to drag that along with me, like you were saying, Ron. So guys, this has been helpful for me. Give me a final thought, if you could, in about 30 seconds or so, to really kind of personalize your experience and how this has such meaning for you.
I think quickly, from your inspiration and motivation to do, you know, spend time with God and to go in deep and find out more things that are benefiting your Christian life today, you share those with us sometimes, and that intrigues me, and that makes me have further victories. If we go to the Word of God, which cannot fail us, that's how we help one another along the way. We don't have to gloss it over. We don't have to make it look like something it isn't, or put it in a PC kind of language today. We can take the word as it states.
Well, thanks, Wayne. Ron?
You know, I think of the passage in Romans 12, 1 and 2, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed.
Hallelujah.
By the renewing of your mind. And through the Bible, I found so many helpful tips on how to have that transformation of thinking that helps us see ourselves in a totally different light. And if we will look at ourselves and try to look at ourselves the way Jesus looks at us as a new child in Christ, it helps us realize that our orientation is in Him.
Amen.
As a royal child of God.
Wow, so that's great. Thank you guys for those closing comments. One of the things that I realize more and more is that by being called a gay Christian, we're really, it's a handicap. You're leaving us with a handicap. And because of our past, because of our experience in Christ, we know that those things have to go to be able to walk in the fullness of what God has created us to be. So thank you for this lively discussion, and we hope that you'll come back and join us again on Pure Choices.